I kind of don't want to do traditional introduction because this isn't a traditional speaker that you're about to hear. I actually first met Audrey in 2012 at Stanford, where weird synchronicity had brought us together, and also other people in the room who are laughing at that joke. Honestly, was intimidated to meet her. My colleague Jesse Snowell behind the camera here had talked about Audrey a lot, and about Audrey's not only wit but also her really intense focus on critique of the educational technology world and education and higher ed in general as well, and that she was irascible, and that is absolutely true of her, but. You meet her, and she's wonderful, and she's a lovely human being, also irascible. it's impossible to even have just dinner without something coming up that feels like, you know, like we're going to have like an intense conversation here. It's just good not to have food you can throw anywhere you want. No, but Audrey is really wonderful. She's the author of Hack Education. Which is a tremendous blog that every person in here should subscribe to, and a book, The Monsters of Education, Monsters of Education, which you can buy online. It's as a digital book, or you can download it as like, can you order a paper?
You can order
a paperback as well.
Amazon.
Which also everybody should absolutely do because it's amazing. So really, without further ado, I will give you Audrey Waters.
Thank you. Thank you for that kind introduction that mostly left out the details of our events in Stanford. I'm actually thrilled. I'm thrilled to be here today in Madison. Once upon a time, a long, long time ago, when I was a graduate student, I sort of imagined the University of Wisconsin-Madison being like the dream job. And so I actually sort of chuckle heartily that it took me dropping out of a PhD program, likely, to have been invited here to speak to you today. But I'm also sort of outraged with the attempts to sort of decimate, not sort of, it's straight up attempts to decimate the University of Wisconsin system, not just the attacks on tenure and academic freedom, but really crushing of any semblance of a dream job. And I have to say, I feel as though academia hasn't responded well to these pressures. It hasn't responded at all, in some cases, to the forces that make this particular moment happening here and happening elsewhere. It's not really just the politics of Scott Walker or education reform. I mean, this is really something that's happening, and it's very much intertwined with issues of technology, Silicon Valley, and venture capitalism. And I think that we're at a moment where powerful people want to reshape what education looks like. They want to reshape it in ways that suit their own ideological and financial needs. And I think in the future, in their future, the losers will be labor, and the losers will be learning. So with that in mind, I sort of changed what my original title was. You know, you have to give a title so early in advance. I'm talking sort of about the same thing, somewhat different today. In 1913, Thomas Edison predicted that books will soon be obsolete in schools. He wasn't the only person at the time thinking about the ways in which emergent technologies were going to change education. Columbia University education psychology professor, behaviorist, and the inventor of the multiple choice test, Edward Thorndike, also imagined, what if print books could be replaced? He said in 1912, quote, if by a miracle of mechanical ingenuity, a book could be so arranged that only to him who had done what was directed on page one would page two become visible, and so on. Much that now requires personal instruction could be managed by print. For his part, Edison expanded his prediction about a decade later. He said, "I believe that the motion picture is destined to revolutionize our education system, and that in a few years, it will supplant largely, if not entirely, the use of textbooks." He continued, "I should say that on average, we get about 2% efficiency out of textbooks. In the future, education, as I see it, will be conducted through the medium of the motion picture, where it will be possible to obtain 100% efficiency." What's interesting to me about these quotations isn't that Edison or Thorndike got it wrong, right? In fact, Thorndike's remarks sound an awful lot like one of my favorite science fiction books, Neal Stephenson's The Diamond Age. And in fact, I think they're fairly prescient to what edtech marketers like to call adaptive textbooks today. And that education technology today looks a lot like Thorndike's vision in 1912 is because, as historians have noted, the history of the 20th century education is that Thorndike won and Dewey lost. You know, history is full of faulty proclamations about the future of education and technology. No doubt, Silicon Valley today still loves to churn out these predictions, prophesizing the doom, the coming doom of the university, actively working to dismantle our public higher education system. But to me, what's striking about these 20th century predictions is that Thorndike set the tone over 100 years ago for machines taking over instruction, right? And while he was wrong about films replacing textbooks, I think Edison was right. He was largely right that one of the major arguments for why we would adopt instructional technology would be this thing, this obsession with efficiency, right? Much of the history of education technology, in fact, the history of education itself, involves this push for efficiency, to replace, to supplant, to move from textbooks to film, or from the chalkboard to the interactive whiteboard, or from the lecture hall to the MOOC, or from the teacher to the robot. This comes in the name of progress, and progress demands efficiency. Of course, efficiency is the language of business, right? We, and I use that first person plural pronoun loosely here, we want education to be faster, cheaper, less wasteful. As such, we want a system that's measurable, manageable, and in turn, increasingly mechanized. Right? We want education to run like a business. We want education to run like a machine. And I use the verb mechanized and not computerized and not digitized, even though here we are at a digital pedagogy lab, because I want us to think about the history of education technology. And more broadly, technology itself. This pressure to mechanize is not new, right? As Edison and Thorndike remind us, edtech predates the iPad, it predates the internet, it predates the personal computer, it certainly predates Khan Academy, right? But we get so caught up in these stories about the novelty of technology. We are so enthralled by its marketing. It's always new and improved, right? We are so willing to buy into obsolescence, and buy is really the operative word here. We are so hopeful about upgrades that we rarely look at the practices of technology. We rarely look what technology does not change. We rarely ask what actually it might be reinscribing. We do not think about the ways in which these often reflect the demands of politics and power much more often than they would reflect progressive pedagogical concerns or certainly learners' or teachers' needs. So I want to talk a little bit today about the history of teaching machines, and I want to talk about teaching machines and teaching labor, specifically the belief that machines are necessary because they're efficient, right? They're labor-saving. you know, here we are again at the University of Wisconsin, and these questions are so imperative. Whose labor, what labor is being saved? Whose labor, what labor is being replaced? In this age of economic precarity, adjunctification, anti-unionism, and automation, what the hell are we doing with education technology, right? What is the role of labor, of scholarly labor, of learning labor, and what, I would ask, is the role of the labor of love? So many people like to insist that technology will not replace teachers, and they sort of chuckle, oh, that's not what we mean at all. But then they will often invoke this famous statement by Arthur C. Clarke, right, that that if a teacher can be replaced by a machine, that he or she should be. I think that that's an awfully slippery slope. Can be replaced gives politicians and investors and entrepreneurs and administrators a lot of room to maneuver, right? To reinscribe and to redefine teaching. What teaching by humans and what teaching by machines might look like. Can be replaced is not a solid place to sort of stage your resistance, right? It already acquiesces to the machine. It already acquiesces to this ideology of labor-saving devices. You know, much like the flawed predictions about what education technology will revolutionize, these pronouncements about replacing teachers with machines are actually also quite old. Made by the earliest education psychologists like Edward Thorndike, made by the people who at the outset were designing teaching machines. People have been working to replace, to streamline, to render more efficient education labor with machines for over a century now. Ohio State professor Sidney Pressey said in 1933 that there must be an industrial revolution in education in which education science and the ingenuity of education technology combine to modernize the grossly inefficient and clumsy procedures of conventional education. Work in the schools of the future, he said, will be marvelously organized so as to adjust almost automatically to individual differences and the characteristics of the learning process. There will be many labor-saving schemes, he said, and devices, machines, not at all for mechanizing education, of course not, but for freeing the teacher from the from educational drudgery and freeing the pupil from incompetence. So it's never like replace you, teacher, right? Just some of your labor, right? Just the bits that we've deemed repetitive or menial or unimportant or, let's be honest, perhaps a little too radical, right? Not to stop students from having to do menial bullshit tasks. Oh no, we'll use machines for that for sure, right? But you know, we want to replace the efforts where teachers have been labeled incompetent. We want to replace not so as to enable, again, a progressive education using technology, but rather to hard code in the sorts of standards of instruction and in discipline that these men have fantasized about. Harvard psychology professor, and really he's the name most readily associated with teaching machines, B.F. Skinner said, will machines replace teachers? On the contrary, they are capital equipment to be used by teachers to save time and labor. In assigning certain mechanizable functions to machine, the teacher emerges in his proper role as an indispensable human being. He may teach more students than ever before, which is probably inevitable if the worldwide demand for education is to be satisfied, but he will do so in fewer hours and with fewer burdensome chores. In return for his greater productivity, he can ask society to improve his economic condition. Greater productivity, larger classes, a global demand met through mechanization. Sound familiar, right? Skinner also said in the 1950s, there's no reason why the schoolroom would be any less mechanized than the kitchen. This very gendered nature of post-war gadgetry, right, that promised to automate and alleviate the drudgery of women's work. I mean, women of a certain class, right? And tasks of a certain kind for a certain cost. But I think, you know, keep this in mind as we think about how labor, how robots taking over our jobs is gendered. The mid-1950s, the same time that Skinner was writing, also marked the founding of a new field of research, artificial intelligence, that promised better machines, right? Not just more efficient machines, but intelligent machines, smarter machines. And once again, these sort of sweeping pronouncements were made. Machines will be capable within 20 years of doing any work a man can do. MIT professor Marvin Minsky said, within a generation, the problem of creating artificial intelligence will be substantially solved. You know, as with Edison, we can chuckle at their foolish bravado, right? But I think it's a mistake to really laugh off these miscalculations of early AI. I think they reveal a great deal about what people want to see happen then and now. And indeed, here we are again, happens every decade or so, in the midst of another hype cycle about the promises of smart machines and artificial intelligence and this frenzied speculation about the impact that they're going to have on the future of work. We're entering a new phase of human history, we're told, in which fewer and fewer workers will be needed to produce the goods and services for the global population. Before the end of the century, says Wired Magazine's Kevin Kelly, 70% of today's occupations will be replaced by automation. The Economist has a more rapid timeline. Nearly half of American jobs could be automated in a decade or two, it says. Of course, predictably, contrarian Matt Iglesias, who none of us should listen to anyway, laments that robots aren't taking our jobs, and that's a problem. Be terrified, Maddie cautions, that robots aren't replacing you. Humans are just not productive enough. We're just not efficient enough. The rise of the machines, like all predictions, really, right? Religious, scientific, it's inevitable. Don't question it. It is, to echo the title of Kevin Kelly's book, What Technology Wants. And that title is so fascinating to me. In that title, we can see this convenient erasure of engineers, entrepreneurs, and investors. Instead, agency is in the machine, right? It's what the machines want. The machines have the will to which the rest of us need to bend. So what happens when machines replace us looks very different depending on who's telling the story. And in some ways, replacing us is what robots have always, always been conceptualized to do. In 1920, the playwright Carol Chapek coined the term robot for his play Rossum's Universal Robots, or RUR. The word comes from the Czech roboti, which means serf labor. Drudgery is another translation, or Wikipedia says it's the amount of hours a serf owned his master in a given day. The robots in Chapek's play aren't metallic machines like the word conjures for us today. They're actually biological, assembled from a protoplasm-like substance. In the play's first act, a young woman named Helena, daughter of an industry mogul, visits the island factory where the robots are being built. She's there as the League of Humanity, right? She wants to argue that robots have souls and they should be freed. The robots, which in the play work cheaper and faster than humans, actually they're not paid at all, have quickly taken over almost all aspects of work. They remember everything, but they don't like anything. They sure make great university professors, the general manager of the robot factory says. As the play progresses and the robots start taking over all aspects of the economy, the human birth rate falls. The robots stage a rebellion, a global rebellion as, unlike humans, robots share a universal language. They recognize the universality of their labor struggles. Hoping to stop the economic and political crisis, Helena burns the formula for creating robots. But the robots kill all the humans anyways, except for one guy left on the island who still works with his hands. But then the robots discover that the formula's been burned. and they cannot reproduce. And at the end of the play, one of them says, "The machines are turning out nothing but bloody chunks of meat." You know, Chapek's play was translated into over 30 languages. It was performed all around the world. The success of the play occurred, no doubt, in the 1920s as people were really, really concerned about automation, industrialization, war, machines. And the play demands, I think, the audiences consider what is happening to our humanity as a result of these forces. And I think that that's the question that robots always raise for us. Robots in literature and in science fiction, in film, in plays, and of course in the technology blogs. What is happening to our humanity? As we mechanize and now digitize our world, what happens to our labor? Right? What happens to love? What happens to our soul? Are we poised to find ourselves exterminated by the robots, right? Or like the robots themselves, are we simply going to become these bloody chunks of meat? You know, we see headline after headline today, lately, about the coming AI revolution. But I think as Chapek's work reminds us, this is really sort of a psychological threat, right? This is an ideological threat as much as it is a technological one. I mean, no doubt we have seen in the last few decades, really, work has changed immensely because of machines, right? Computers, photocopiers, fax machines, telephones, ATM machines, online commerce. And certainly in the last few decades, our economy has changed as well. We've lost millions of manufacturing jobs. Although in fairness, really the connection to automation is probably much more correlation than causation. But robots offer a really simple explanation, right? Human labor was not sufficiently efficient. Robots will increase productivity. And at the same time as we've seen this drop in manufacturing, right, the US economy has seen an explosion in the service sector, which now amounts for 84% of employment in the country. The service sector does include doctors and lawyers and university professors, right, but most of it is low wage work. Since 2010, the top five fastest growing occupations have been in the service sector. Four of these jobs have a median wage of less than $21,000 a year. Coincidentally, I'm sure, workers are less organized today than they were at the height of manufacturing. In the US, of course, union members were really never close to the majority of the workforce. But in 2014, the percentage of workers in unions was 11.1%, down from 20.1% in 1983. Workers in education, as I'm sure this audience knows, now have the highest unionization rate of any profession in the country. 35.3% are union members. The rate of unionization across the public sector in general, 35.7%. The largest union in the US, the National Education Association. The target of many education reforms, backed strongly by the technology industry, unions. So something is coming for unionized teachers' jobs, right? Whether it's robots or something else. So generally speaking, as employment has moved from manufacturing to service, work has become contingent, casualized, adjunctified, and it has become feminized. We can see the feminization of teaching labor in general. This is something that Dana Goldstein talks about in her history of the teaching profession, right? It's deeply intertwined with a hope for a placated labor force, one that has a missionary zeal, right? One that will be loving in its demand that students behave intellectually, but that makes few demands from administrators for pay equity, for job stability, and for academic freedom. In all things, in all tasks, in all jobs, women are expected to perform this sort of affective labor, right? Caring, listening, smiling, reassuring, comforting, supporting. This work is not valued, often it is underpaid, unpaid even. But affective labor has become a core part of the teaching profession, even though it is, no doubt, quite inefficient. It is what we expect, stereotypically at least, for teachers to do. I think we can debate whether or not we reward that, for professors, right? And I think we can interrogate, too, whether all students receive care and support. Certainly, some get no excuses, depending on race and class. But what happens to affective teaching labor when it runs up against the robots, when it runs up against automation? Even the tasks that education technology today purports to be able to automate, teaching, testing, grading, these are shot through with emotion when done by humans, or at least when done by a person who's supposed to have a caring, supportive relationship with students. Grading essays, for example, is not necessarily burdensome because it is menial, right? Grading essays is burdensome because it is affective labor. It demands emotional as well as intellectual work. And for that reason, it's exhausting. And so I think this is part of our conundrum as we think about the future of work in the university. Teaching labor is affective. It's not simply intellectual. Affective labor is not valued. Intellectual labor is valued when it's seen as research. At both the K-12 and college level, teaching of content is viewed as menial, as repetitive, as routine, and can be replaced by a machine. Intelligent machines will soon handle the task of cultivating human intellect, or so we're told. And of course, I think we should ask, so what happens when we remove affect, when we remove care from education? This is a question for labor and for learning. What happens to thinking and writing, for example, when robots grade student essays? What happens when testing is standardized and automated? What happens when the whole education process is offloaded to machines, to intelligent tutoring systems, to adaptive learning systems, or whatever we want to call them? What sort of signals are we sending our students? And what sort of signals are the machines gathering in turn? What learning about us are they doing? Often, of course, we don't know the answer to these questions, as the code and the algorithms in education technology, in most technologies, truth be told, are hidden from us. We are becoming, as Professor Frank Pasquale says, a black box society. And the irony is hardly lost on me that one of the promises of mass collections of student data under the guise of education technology and learning analytics is to crack open the black box of the human brain. We still know very little about how the brain works, and yet we've adopted all sorts of metaphors from our understanding of that organ to explain how computers work. Memory, language, intelligence. Of course, our notion of intelligence, right, its measurability, has its own history, one wrapped up in eugenics, and of course in testing and teaching machines. Machines now both frame and are framed by this question of intelligence, with very little reflection on the sort of ideological baggage that they carry forward and hard code into them. Can a machine think? Alan Turing famously asked in 1950. But rather than answer that question, Turing proposed an imitation game, something we've come to know as the Turing test. Contrary to popular belief, the test as conceived by Turing isn't really about whether or not a machine can pass based on thinking. Rather, Turing's original contrivance was based on a parlor game, a gendered parlor game, involving three people, a man, a woman, and an interlocutor. The game is played as follows. The interrogator cannot see the man or the woman, but asks them questions in order to identify their sex. The man and the woman respond, ideally, Turing says, with typewritten answers. The goal of the man is to fool the interrogator. Turing's twist, replace the man with the machine, right? Will the interrogator decide wrongly as often when the game is played like this, Turing asks, as when the game is played between a man and a woman? So the classic question of Turing's test is not, can a machine think? It's, can a machine fool someone into thinking it's a woman? So what we know of today as the Turing test is not nearly so fascinating or fraught. I mean, what does it mean that the bar for intelligent machinery is that, right? That it has to be, that a machine has to be better at pretending to be a woman than a man is? What would it mean for a machine to be able to pass that imitation game? What would it mean if a machine can fool us into thinking, for example, that it can perform affective labor, not just computational tasks? Today, really, the Turing test is mostly a marketing ploy. The Loebner Prize, which is an annual competition based on the test, for example, asks entrants to create a chatbot that can fool judges after having a 5-minute conversation into thinking it and not another human is the human. The contest offers an award to the most human chatbot, and it also awards a prize, which should give us pause, for the human who is the most human, right? Turing, let's remember, for his part, was not seen as human. He was not seen as fully human because he was gay. Homosexuality was at the time against the law in Britain, and Turing was charged with gross indecency in 1952. He was convicted, opting for hormonal treatment rather than imprisonment, and he committed suicide in 1954. So identity, performance, deception, passing, secrets, labor, algorithms, these are Turing's legacy, deeply embedded in a code-breaking computational machine. And we carry these forward in education technology. Turing died before the term artificial intelligence was coined, but we can see his influence, particularly in two areas the AI has developed, where we see it's judged and performed, chess and the chatbot. Turing wrote by hand an algorithm even before the actual first computer, which is remarkable, a program where a machine could play chess against a human. This was the predecessor for IBM's Deep Blue, which famously defeated the chess champion Kasparov in 1996. That research, in turn, was the predecessor for IBM's Watson, which famously beat Brad Rutter and Ken Jennings on the TV show Jeopardy. Men versus machine. It's perhaps a tangent, I think, to the discussion about teaching, learning, and labor, you might think, but we think of those games as performances of smart, right? Performances of smartness matter to education, and also IBM is now considering using Watson in schools to teach teachers. The classroom will learn you, I swear to God, is on the IBM website as to describe this program. I think totally unaware of the meme, right, in Soviet Russia. You know, aspirations for Watson in teacher training aside, I think that it's the development of chatbots that have really been most important in AI, and also what we expect the AI to do to pass the Turing test. One of the earliest and best-known chatbots was developed by MIT computer scientist Joseph Weizenbaum in the mid-1960s. Its name, Eliza, named after Eliza Doolittle, the working-class character in George Bernard Shaw's play Pygmalion, who is taught to speak with an upper-class accent so she can pass. Eliza ran a doctor script, so it simulated a psychiatrist. Hello, you might type. Hi, Eliza would respond. What's your problem? I'm angry, you might say. Or perhaps I'm sad. I'm sorry to hear you are sad, Eliza would respond. My dad died, you continue. Tell me more about your family, Eliza would answer. The script always eventually got to the question, tell me more about your family, no matter what you typed. It had been programmed to do so, right? Eliza was programmed to sort of analyze the keywords and then to respond with the language of therapy, with the language of care, with the language of support. It was a performance of smart, right? But it was a performance of care. Weizenbaum's students at MIT knew. They knew Eliza didn't care. but they were still eager to chat with it. They wanted to divulge personal information to it. Weizenbaum became really frustrated with the ease with which he felt this very simple program could deceive people. When he introduced Eliza to the non-technical staff at MIT, according to one story at least, they treated the program as a real therapist. When he told a secretary that he had access to all the chat logs, she was furious. She said that he had violated doctor-patient confidentiality. She violated his privacy by reading the chat logs. Weizenbaum eventually became one of the leading outspoken critics of artificial intelligence. He cautioned about the implications of this research, and he argued that no matter the claims that people would make about these being powerful thinking machines, they would never be powerful caring machines. Computers will never have compassion. And yet, we don't seem to care. Right? In some ways, we believe, we want to believe, that they are. Many chatbots were developed throughout the late 20th century for use in education. They're often referred to as pedagogical agents, interestingly, not teachers, but they were programs that were part of the early intelligent tutoring systems, and that, like Eliza, were designed to respond helpfully, kindly, when a student stumbled. The effectiveness of these chatbots is debated in the research, and I think we could debate what we mean by effectiveness of edtech in general, and there's not a lot of understanding about how students responded, particularly around issues of vulnerability and trust, which are really core, I think, to learning. But here's the question. Are chatbots sophisticated enough to pass some sort of pedagogical Turing test, right? And is that test, like Turing's imitation game, fundamentally gendered? Or rather, as I fear, is it that we've decided we don't care? We don't care. We don't care that machines do not care for students. Indeed, I think at the university level in particular, not really ever cared for students at all. Not really. And I think students don't care that machines don't care, because they don't actually expect the humans that interact with them at the university to care. We expect more from technology and less from each other, Sherry Turkle has observed. Caring labor is a vulnerability. It's a vulnerability. It's a political liability, it's a weakness, and it is inefficient. So what does that mean? What does it mean then if we can offload affective labor, the substantive, the meaningful, and the performative, to technology, to ed tech? It might seem counterintuitive that we do so, right? After all, we're told all the time that computers will never be able to do that sort of work. They're better at repetitive, menial tasks, we're told, physical labor, men's work. The age of robot workers will be worse for men, The Atlantic just said last week. Oh my God, terrible for men, you're gonna be feminized. And at the same time, we seem perfectly happy to bare our souls, to trust our secrets, to be vulnerable with and to computers. So what does that mean for teaching and learning? What does that mean if our students want to be more vulnerable to machines than with each other and with us? What does that mean for the work that educators do? What does that mean when that work has been under attack for centuries now as being insufficient and inefficient? You know, we're actually told at the same time by some automation proponents not to worry, that the future of work will be a future of leisure. Once the robots replace us, I don't know where they go. They live in gold palaces already, I guess that's where they come from. Once the robots replace us, we will have immense personal freedom. The freedom to pursue all sorts of unproductive tasks. The freedom to do nothing at all, even, except, I imagine, continue to buy the latest computer crap. On one hand, that means we have to address questions of unemployment, right? What will we do without work? How will we make ends meet? What will this mean about for identity, for intellectual development? And yet, despite all these predictions that the end of the work is near, we are all, in fact, working more. As games theorist Ian Bogos and others have observed, we're actually in this strange period of unemployment that is hyperemployment, where we find ourselves not only working numerous jobs, but working all the time on and for technology platforms. There is no escaping email. There is no escaping social media. Professionally, personally, no matter what you say in your Twitter bio, that your tweets are not representative of the opinion of your employer, you are working for someone every time you tweet. It's Twitter. We are all working. Computers and AI do not mark the end of work. They mark the opposite. We are overworked now by and for the machines, well, for the companies that own them. And often we volunteer to do this work, right? We are not paid for our status updates on Twitter. We are not compensated for our check-ins on Foursquare or Facebook. We don't get kickbacks for leaving a review on Yelp. I don't think so. We're not supposed to, at least, right? We don't get royalties from our photos on Flickr. And we ask our students to do this volunteer labor too, all the time, all the time. They are not compensated in any way except for a grade, woo-hoo, for the data and content that they generate that is used to feed the algorithms that run Turnitin. Blackboard, Newton, Pearson, Google. Free labor fuels education technology. Forum moderation on Coursera, done by volunteers. Translation in the Coursera courses, done by volunteers. Translation of videos in Khan Academy, done by volunteers. Content pretty much on every Web 2.0 platform, done by volunteers. We're working all the time, we're working for free. It's framed, I think, as late as the sharing economy, or the freelance economy, but really it is still the service economy. It just now has an app in the iTunes store, right? And it's creeping into our personal as well as professional lives thanks to venture capital. Work is still precarious. It's still low prestige. It remains unpaid or underpaid. It remains feminized. So we all are doing affective labor now, cultivating, caring for our networks, responding to the machines, the latest version of Eliza, hoping that someone out there cares as we chat, hoping someone responds and that it's not programmatic, and if it is, oh well, they responded. It's a performance of care. Disguising, I think, is what is really an extraction of our personal data. I wrote about this a year ago in one of the handouts for this conference, an essay called Maggie's Digital Content Farm. I borrowed entirely, actually, from Bob Dylan's song, but in turn, he'd actually stolen it from someone else too. The Bentley Brothers 1929 recording of Down on Penny's Farm, which criticized rural landlords who systematically exploited their day laborers. I felt as though that's what we've become, right? We're working away on someone else's space, someone else's digital land. We're working for a boss that has disrespected us, lied to us, extracted value from us, handed us over to law enforcement if we appeared to have become too radicalized. Dylan's performance at Maggie's Farm was, of course, part of that famous one at the Newport Folk Festival in 1965, when he plugged in. He plugged in, played in an electric set to boos and hisses from the crowd. And so I asked in my article, Maggie's Digital Content Farm, if maybe it was time for us to unplug, or at least refuse to labor on the digital content farms, and certainly not conscript our students to labor there alongside us. But you know, the more I think about it now, I think the refusal can't really just be one of us, or two of us, or a handful of us, or even everyone in this class, in this room. I think we have to really strike en masse. I think we have to embrace our radical, very human inefficiencies. We have to rediscover our collectivity in an age that is luring us with this ideology of individualism and efficiency. We have to tell different stories about what we want the robots to do. We're told that the future of machines, teaching machines, and intelligent machines will be highly personalized. And that sounds so lovely. You know, that's the promise, I think, when we think back to Edward Thorndike in 1912, right? If by a miracle of mechanical ingenuity, a book could be so arranged that only to him who'd done what was directed on page one would page two become visible. And that much that requires personal instruction would be managed by print. Personalization, automation, management. The algorithms will be crafted based on our data, ostensibly to suit us individually, more likely to suit the power structures in which we find are now increasingly opaque. You know, programmatically, the world's interfaces will be crafted for each of us, we're told, individually, alone. And I fear that we will lose our capacity to experience collectivity and joy and resist together. I don't know what the future of unions looks like. I think it's pretty grim, but I do know that we have to find some way to build collective action in order to resist a future of technological exploitation, dehumanization, and economic precarity. And we have to fight at the level of infrastructure, political infrastructure, social infrastructure, and technical infrastructure. And it isn't simply that we need to resist the robots are taking our jobs bullshit, but we have to challenge the ideologies that loathe collectivity, that loathe care and creativity, and that champion some sort of Randian individual. I think the three strands at this event are really a key part of that. Networks, identity, and praxis. How can we leverage those to a more radical end? You know, the future of teaching humans and not teaching machines depends on how we respond and how we design a critical ethos for edtech. One that recognizes, I think, for example, the very gendered question at the heart of that Turing machine and its imagined capabilities. It's a parlor game that has tricked us into believing that machines can love, and that machines can learn, and that machines can care. And I fear not a future where the question is, can a machine think? But I fear the sort of twisted inverse of the Turing machine, the future that we seem to be spiraling towards. And that is, how much more machine-like can we make sure our students become? Thank you. So I guess I'm contractually obligated to take a question. Or a comment.
Raise your hand and we will bring a mic to you.
Got any questions?
I can't actually believe I'm asking this, but can you try to define care? Which sounds obnoxious, like, how's that? But like really, what do you mean when you talk about care?
Ooh, that's a great question. So, I mean, I think it's an ethics. I think it's loving another human being and recognizing that being is a person, not an object, right? That is someone that should have, and I'm thinking about this in terms of a classroom in particular, someone whose subjectivity should be recognized and not seen as the object to which we do things in school, but rather a person who is becoming. And I think that creating, I don't like the phrase safe space, but I think a caring space is one in which we recognize the vulnerability in each other as teachers and learners, and we love each other through that. And it is about emotion and not just mind. Not just intellect.
Thank you.
It's probably about bodies too.
Hi, really enjoyed your talk and have a question for you about, can you speak to ways we might leverage not just agency in the institution, but thinking about the network and the World Wide Web and activism outside, you know, preparing our learners. So that notion of care and ethics of care that's actually social change, you know, hashtag say your name, you know, the 99%ers, I mean, how do we bring that more formally into education?
Yeah, I mean, I think that to me, that is sort of what we should always be doing, right? Is that we live in this world. We are of this world, and our students are of this world. And I think that we have to help them recognize both the infrastructure of the world around them systematically, right? And how can they identify the places in which that is oppressive, the places in which that's weak, and they can sort of exert and make change. And I think that that's why the question of agency is so important. It's why I hate that phrase, what technology wants. It's why these predictions that are handed out as though these are fortune tellers that can tell us in 10 years' time the world is going to look a certain way, we make that world. A world in which there are only 10 universities, I mean, lots of things have to change for that to come to pass. And none of these things are inevitable. Technology is not inevitable. The web is not inevitable. We can make the world better. I believe that. That's why, I think teachers believe that. If we didn't believe in making the world better, we probably would be in Silicon Valley making a shit ton of money right now on these skills that we have.
So I'm a computer scientist and a computer science educator. So
excellent.
What advice would you have for us that you're portraying as the enemy?
Oh, the enemy. I think that one of the problems I think with computer science is that it has benefited greatly from seeing itself as today's wizards, right? And wizards, like the Wizard of Oz, don't particularly like it when we pull back the curtain and see that it's actually just a snake oil salesman from Nebraska, if I'm recalling my Frank L. Baum correctly. So I think that we have to recognize that technology is not magic, and that there are ways in which we should all understand better how it operates. I think we want to be able to look beneath the surface of how these tools work, these tools that are everyday parts of our lives now. I think it's really important to understand how the web works. I think it's really important to understand how the algorithms that decide your credit rating work. Facebook just patented last week a tool that would allow it to assign a credit rating based on your friends. Well, that's terrible. And so I think we should understand the way in which the algorithms, the code works. And so rather than running from it, I think we need to run up to it and kick it. I mean, kick it, you know, to test the wheels, not to hurt it.
I wonder if you could provide some examples of the process you were talking about, part of the talk about, kind of the mechanization of grading, mm-hmm. and the sort of risk that poses to our profession, as well as, I'll say something about that. I treated a couple examples originated from the former vice chair of the department that I came from. So I'm sure there are others that you know, I'd be interested to hear just kind of what wave it is that we're facing there. And also, you know, what sort of sites of resistance you think we have as faculty, as well as maybe our students, to kind of push back against this tide of mechanization when it comes to not just the teaching, but particularly as you were talking about the grading process.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, on one hand, I think that Turnitin is a pretty great example of a technology that is sort of dastardly on several levels, least of which being they sort of claim a sort of sweeping license to students' work that's submitted. They don't claim copyright, but they do claim a license to it that then feeds their algorithm so that they can identify if the paper that Johnny submitted this semester is the same that, you know, his fraternity brother submitted last semester. And I think that that's, I don't imagine that faculty would be too cool with their peer-reviewed articles or dissertations running through the Turnitin machine. They would say, no way, that is my IP, I own it. How dare you even presume that I'm a plagiarist? So I think that Turnitin is a tool that sort of automatically assumes that students are criminal. But furthermore, like, that's why I hear often that, well, we use these, we'll be able to grade more student papers more quickly. And someone who taught freshman writing for a long time, there's a certain appeal to not facing your stack of 30 essays. I get that. I totally get that. But then also, I think that the flip side of the question, it's one of the things that I never see in these demands, even from, you know, the early 1900s, to automate these processes, is why are we making students do meaningless work? Like, why don't we have students do things that are meaningful and important and that are not just not plagiarizable, that's like the wrong thing, but like, why can't students be doing important, meaningful things that matter to them? Well, there you go. And so, I mean, I think that that's the question. It's like, how do we rethink assignments? Not just how do we make essay grading more efficient? That's like, that's the wrong lever, or that's a really lousy lever to pull. It's like, how do we get students to actually contribute to scholarship in a meaningful way? The web makes that possible. So I think that, to me, those are the more interesting questions.
Time for one more?
Sure. There was one. Did you have a question up at the front? Oh, well, then two more.
Fine.
Yeah, two more.
Three more.
Three more.
Room for all my friends. This is actually from Twitter. This is Donna Langclose is asking.
What shoes I'm wearing? I'm wearing my Doc Martens.
She's wearing her Doc Martens, Donna. What are the mechanisms by which we create space for inefficiencies in institutions where efficient is read as effective?
Lie. No, I'm kidding. I'm totally kidding. No, I think that's tough. I mean, I think that people who have tenure, for example, people who have a voice in their department, for example, can stop with some of the, I did this, then therefore my students have to do this as well. I mean, I think that sort of replicating these systems are partly what is so frustrating to me about academia, is that it's sort of deliberately, or not deliberately, it has sort of blindly found itself in a position where it has created the adjunct labor problem in part by churning out massive numbers of PhD students, because professors like having a seminar where they can talk with five people who are specialists in their field and do cool things which are more interesting to them than teaching Shakespeare 101. So I think that the faculty who have tenure, I think it's completely up to the faculty who have tenure to pull their shit together. And I do think it has to come from faculty leadership recognizing that what we demand students to do shouldn't be meaningful, and that it can be messy, and then it doesn't have to look like the kinds of essays that students wrote in high school, but it doesn't have to look like the kind of essays that they wrote in their sophomore year either. We're creative people, we could probably do better.
Well, I guess mine's kind of a two-part thing in that I actually was somewhat surprised at the almost vitriol I kind of got from about mechanisms and machinery and such for teaching, because I'm a physician. I went through medical school, and I think mechanization could be tremendously useful in, you know, transferring information, because so much of medical school is simply just you go to a lecture and you listen to someone, you memorize everything they said, you memorize everything for the test, and what isn't spent the time on is teaching you how to think and how to logic and how to continue to use what information you have and how to question the information you have and utilize it for your life. So I guess, you know, I look at it that I actually welcome, I'd love to see that instead of large lecture halls, whether on a university or medical school, I wish there were no lecture halls and everyone were able to watch the best person who transferred this information perform, because to me a lot of that's just a performance, somebody standing in front saying, here you are, here is what it is, but that the teachers would learn how to better educate everyone, regardless of what field they're in, how to think. Because when I see the faults in medicine now, it's mainly because people didn't think. They stopped thinking. They use what they learned by rote memory and applied that to all situations and can't recognize when it's a little different.
So I think that, I mean, to me, I think one of the things that we confuse memorization for actually being understanding. And I think that that's a flaw not just in medical education, but often in the sciences in general, where you're taught is that if you sort of memorize all the bones in the body, for example, or you can list the names of all the planets or the moons around Saturn, somehow you have an understanding. I mean, I confess, I come from, you know, I believe that you learn by making, that you learn by doing, that you learn by, not by being able to rattle off lists and numbers and dates and facts, but you learn by actually being able to synthesize and understand and contextualize and do things. So, I mean, I think that there's probably huge flaws in the way in which medical education operates. I don't know, I'm not a doctor, not even a PhD. But I can't imagine that mechanizing memorization is actually the place where we should focus on fixing things. I feel as though we should focus on perhaps more opportunities for hands-on learning, more lab, more cadavers, and less apps. Quote that.
I think there was a hand right over here somewhere.
Thank you for the great talk. I was struck by the sort of eugenic fantasy of a lot of the earlier sort of pictures of mechanized education, that once we get efficient teaching machines in place, student difference won't matter anymore, right? The students will be educable along the way, and you even brought in eugenics a couple of times, this picture that if only we change this thing, the problems of bodies or the problems of minds won't be there anymore, right? Very typical to have a future where disability is no longer a thing. And I'm wondering, for the versions of intelligent teaching machines that we have now, they also promise a kind of eugenic future where students won't have deficiencies anymore. What does that then say about students who don't succeed with these machines? What's wrong with them? What's the new deficiency put onto them, if that makes sense? Why should they fail at these new and improved systems? What are we blaming them for now?
Well, my friend Tressie McMillan-Cottom has this great phrase, the roaming autodidact, and that she uses that's the framework within a lot of these contemporary education technologies sort of imagine students. Students are all bodiless, white, male, self-directed learner of a certain global north with a certain background and class that are just able to learn things, learn anything they want, anytime they want, as long as they watch a video or two. Like, that's the sort of imagined learner. So I think that there's almost an inability in that sort of, within that framework, to imagine students who do struggle, who struggle for a variety of reasons, because the imagined learner is someone who just, I'm just gonna spend the next 20 days learning JavaScript, and then God damn it, I'm gonna move to San Francisco and be a programmer. I mean, it's a fantasy of how certain people have experienced learning things on their own that doesn't jive with my experiences having learned things. And it's a very individualized view in which it's all up to you. There's no sort of structural things in your way. It's just you, the learner, alone with your MOOC. And that I think that it's sort of unimagined that people would not learn otherwise. Those people who drop out are lazy. And they will not survive in the future of robots. And there's just sort of a shrug, a Randian shrug. That's just the way it's gonna be. I mean, no, it's not gonna be that way. Because we're all gonna make sure it's not that way, right? Right.
All right, cool. Thank you so much, Audrey. Really appreciate it.